Thou shalt not bow down to them, nor to worship them.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Remember that thou keep holy the Sabbath day.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Honor thy father and thy mother.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt do no murder.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not steal.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not covet.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and by all these laws in our hearts, we beseech thee.
Going over to the bottom of page 319, hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. The second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the laws and the prophets. Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left unmeasured. We have not loved thee with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in thy will and walk in thy ways to the glory of thy name. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant you absolution and remission of all your sins, true repentance and amendment of life, and the grace and consolation of his Holy Spirit. Amen. And now turning over to page 324, we will sing the Hosanna.
Thank you. A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. When you have come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling in his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, "Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us." When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God: "A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number, and there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, the Lord heard our voice. We cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power, and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm this morning is Psalm 91. Let's read it responsibly by half verse. "He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High
abides under the shadow of the Almighty.
He shall say to the Lord, 'You are my refuge and my stronghold,
my God in whom I put my trust.'
Because you have made the Lord your refuge,
and Most High your habitation,
there shall no evil happen to you.
Neither shall any plague come near your dwelling.
For he shall give his angels charge over you,
to keep you in all your ways.
They shall bear you in their hands,
lest you dash your foot against a stone.
You shall tread upon the lion and adder.
You shall trample on the lion and the serpent.
Because he is bound to me in love, therefore will I deliver him.
I will protect him because he knows my name.
He shall call upon me, and I will answer him.
I am with him in trouble. I will rescue him and bring him to honor.
With long life will I satisfy him
and show him my salvation."
A reading from the Epistle to the Romans. "The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, 'No one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.'" Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
After his baptism, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority. For it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Your word is near us, Lord, on our lips and in our hearts. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. So, some of you were here on Ash Wednesday, and if you remember, I shared a phrase and some insight into that phrase from a gentleman named Walter Brueggemann. And remember on Ash Wednesday, what do we say? Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. And the idea that I was trying to get at on Wednesday was that Lent is an opportunity for us to recall once again how wonderfully we have been made, how merciful and full of compassion God is, and into what freedom we have been called to live. And then I shared a quote from this article that these ideas came from by Mr. Brueggemann. The article was, "Remember that you are dust." And he says, and he calls it the dust formula. He's Presbyterian. This liturgical piece is not big a part of his tradition. So he says that the dust formula is an opportunity and an invitation to rethink our true identity as a creature of God, kept alive by God's breath. So, holding that idea that Lent is an opportunity to rethink how we live, let's examine this long journey we are about to go on. This long and arduous journey that we're going to follow with Jesus as he goes all the way to Jerusalem. And while we are journeying, it may feel like the rest of the world is falling apart, but we're really focused on this journey. Now, I don't know about you, but I have problems keeping those two things separate. It just, the world and this journey to Jerusalem all go together. And I haven't quite figured out how it all works out, but that's what we're talking about today. When we read in Scripture over the next few weeks, we're going to hear about the highlights, the turning points in Jesus' life that brought him to this hill outside of Jerusalem that we call Calvary. And as we read each week, we are called to ask, how does this moment, this event, these words of Jesus bring us to some point, some new horizon on our own journey and the journey that the world is on? Because I think both our Lenten journey and the world need some illumination and a whole lot less burden. We have too often let become this heavy thing that we can't even carry. And at some point in our Lenten discipline, we just give up and say, I can't do this any longer. I can't live without my coffee or my cake. I can't live without my candy or my sugar. And we just give up. Lent becomes, for some people, this burden of self-doubt, self-loathing, and a failing of self-worth. And is that what Lent is supposed to be? Absolutely not. But some of us have come from a place where we were taught such theology based on a view of God that was wrathful. Wrathful about our sins. And our sins seemed so great in that tradition that God's mercy and God's grace couldn't touch our lives because we're just so bad. How far from the truth is that? Then I was reading an essay on doubt, and this phrase popped into my head. It was part of one line in this essay. It said, the biggest obstacle to reinventing ourselves may be simply a kind of paralysis of hope. The fact that we can't live a free life in Jesus Christ is because we don't have the hope that we need. At least that's how I rephrase that. Our greatest failure of Lent is not our inability to keep our goals of fasting and praying, but our inability to believe in all that we've been promised. This is a moment of faith and hope versus doubt. Yet everything we hear today is about reminding ourselves, as the colic says, Jesus saves. Who didn't have that bumper sticker on their car in the 60s? Jesus saves. This phrase is exactly what we hear today from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. At the very end, the last, I think, sentence, let me get mine out and let's see if somebody else can read it for me. Yes, who can read the very last sentence from Paul's epistle to the Romans? Not Fawn, she already had to read it. Somebody else. Who wants to be the voice for that one sentence? Come on, somebody's brave. Go, Julie.
Okay, the very last sentence.
Very last sentence.
Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Now let's all read that.
Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Now, this is the real quiz. I don't know if the Bible study group talked about this, the epistle to the Romans. But do you know where that actually comes from? It comes from the prophet Joel. Prophet Joel. Joel is a prophet during the time of, let's see. No, I'm not even going to go there because I can't remember. I have a terrible mind for dates. But he's responding to this terrible worldwide, or at least in his notion, famine that was brought on by a devastating attack of locusts. And it wiped out everything. And Joel writes about the coming darkness and the gloom and the days of clouds and thick darkness. Yet in chapter 2, the one that this quote comes from, Joel proclaims how all of creation need not worry. I mean, talk about climate change. Somebody needs to read chapter 2 of Joel. All of creation. creation need not worry. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done great things. For though there may be dark and terrible days, those who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. That's the key point that we need to remember. The world may be falling apart, but we have one job. And what is that job? We're going to get to that. Lent is our opportunity to explore that notion, that calling on the name of the Lord and what that provides for us. Would anyone ever say about themselves that one of their most positive attributes or characteristics is that they call upon the name of the Lord? Do we ever describe ourselves to our friends that way? No, not at all. Or what about, would we say to somebody, I abide in the Lord Almighty? Now that said, the way I said it sounds kind of offsetting, doesn't it? Like I'm gloating. But that's what we're supposed to be about. Abiding in the shadow of the Almighty. That was in the song. Take Psalm 91 home and read it. It is beautiful. And even though we say it and we want to believe it, it's part of the wilderness that we live in, isn't it? We long to experience that security that Psalm 91 describes. A real sense that the Lord God is our refuge, our stronghold, and the place that we can put our trust. This is where the gospel story is so helpful. It is filled with images of the kinds of temptations that we face today. Now, we have to extrapolate a little. But it's still about temptation and being in the wilderness. True hunger and thirst for control and power. No, there's no need for anyone but ourselves. That's part of the message that the devil's trying to get Jesus to think about. These are the wilderness that we live in too, not just Jesus. How many of you know that it's highly recommended to not go shopping hungry? Right? Because what do? You just buy stuff. Think about Jesus. 40 days, little food, and if we go into a grocery store, what are we going to do? Buy the chocolate candy bar. And yet, that's not what happened, is it? Jesus is here. He's been tempted. And it's just not in the story today. Because if you read the story, the gospel story today, it says, having been tempted not just today, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. This has been going on for a long time. This temptation in the wilderness. And now Jesus is truly famished. He's starving. And the devil says, turn these stones into bread. You can do that. Use your godly power. Feed yourself. And that's what each temptation was about, wasn't it? It's about using the power of God to change the course of Jesus' life. And giving up his mission to be the light of the world. Giving up the idea that he came to serve, not be served. The devil wants him to take up God's power and be an earthly king. Now, why do you think this story is important in this gospel? Because this is exactly what the Hebrew people wanted. They wanted someone with authority and power over all the world. They wanted to rebuke the government of Rome and let the Hebrew people become the ruling power. This gospel narration highlights the significance of how Jesus came to live among us. Not as an earthly ruler with the power of armies behind him. Rather, he came to save each one of us through loving service and sacrifice, not with armies, but with the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus understands the wilderness piece of our lives because he's been there too. Jesus understands the hunger in our lives, not just for the chocolate candy bar or the bowl of ice cream, but the real hunger for love and the real hunger for identity, the real hunger to be seen. He lived through not only hunger, but the constant and annoying doubt that I put in, that the devil kept throwing at him. You know what I would say about the devil? You know who the devil really is in my mind? Of course, the devil is the personification of evil and doubt. And who is our worst tempter? We are. We know that we have doubts. We know that we are our own worst enemy. And we live with that every day. But you know what really the hardest thing for us to say? Jesus, save me. Jesus, be with me. It is far harder for us to give up control of our lives than it is to surrender and abide in the shadow of the Almighty. We just don't know how to do that. So I don't know if this makes sense to you, but I took Psalm 91. You can look at Psalm 91. It's in your bulletin. Go to verses 14 and 15. And sometimes in the Psalms, the writer switches the pronouns all around and it gets really confusing. So I rewrote it like this, starting with verse 14. Because humanity is bound to God in love, I, God, will deliver humanity. And if you don't want to say humanity, put your name in there. I, God, will protect Rhoda because Rhoda knows my name. Humanity will call upon me and I, God, will answer humanity. I, God, will be with humanity in trouble. I, God, will rescue humanity and bring humanity honor if. And what's the if? If I will put my trust in you, God. In John's gospel, we hear these words. Then Jesus cried out, whoever believes in me does not believe in me only, but the one who sent me. The one who looks at me is seeing the one who sent me. I have come into the world as a light so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. That's the good news. God who created us and gave us breath, God who took us from the dust and formed us, is also the God who saves us, who liberates us. God gave his son Jesus to come to be our light in the wilderness, in the darkness, in all those places that we find ourselves stuck in. God sent his son, Jesus, to guide us away from all those temptations that we create for ourselves. God sent his son, Jesus, to show us and to be God's love, to be God's salvation. The old bumper sticker is really our theme for Lent. Jesus saves. Remembering that, living that, that is the greatest Lenten discipline we could take on. Jesus saves us, guides us, shows us how to live with the Lord each and every day. As the psalm says, because we have made the Lord our refuge and our habitation, Jesus saves. Amen.
one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father.
Prayers of the people can be found on page 9 in your bulletin. And I invite you to add your own thanksgivings and petitions in the silences that follow each prayer. Beloved friends, in this season of repentance and healing, we accept God's invitation to be ever mindful of the needs of others, offering our prayers on behalf of God's community in the church and in the world. God of wilderness and water, your Son was baptized and tempted as we are. Guide us through this season, that we may not avoid struggle, but open ourselves to blessing through the cleansing depths of repentance and the heaven-rending words of the Spirit. Jesus Christ, Son of God,
guide us in wisdom, guide us in truth, guide us in love.
We pray for your church throughout the world, for David our bishop and Michael our presiding bishop. With Christ as the rock beneath our feet and our citizenship assured in heaven, help us who bear your name to live with integrity, bringing forth fruit to nourish this hungry world. Jesus Christ, Son of God,
guide us in wisdom, guide us in truth, guide us in love.
We pray for this nation and for all the nations of your world. Whether we are living in righteousness, strengthen us. Wherever we have lost our way, guide us. And make us repentant that we may find the way we should go. Nations who suffer in your name.
Refugees.
Jesus Christ, Son of God,
guide us in wisdom, guide us in truth, guide us in love.
We pray for your world that is fractured by greed and fear, and by privilege and discrimination. Through Christ, make us one with yourself, not counting our trespasses, but grafting us to your gospel of reconciliation, that we, your image bearers, might be transformed into the righteousness of God. We pray for all those who do not yet know you. Jesus Christ, Son of God,
guide us in wisdom, guide us in truth, guide us in love.
We pray for Visalia and all who have made this their home. Create in us a spirit of true community where we, like you, would seek one another's safety and nurture as a hen who gathers her brood under the shadow of her wing. Pray for the meeting tomorrow night of the City Council. Jesus Christ, Son of God,
guide us in wisdom, guide us in truth, guide us in love.
We pray for our family, friends, and neighbors who are laboring beneath burdens too heavy to bear. For refugees and immigrants, for those without homes or adequate employment, for households concealing domestic violence or addiction. Merciful God, join our eyes, our hearts, and our hands to yours, that together we may provide them a way out and give them strength to endure.
We pray for the people fleeing Poland.
Jesus Christ, Son of God,
guide us in wisdom, guide us in truth, guide us in love.
We pray for all those who have asked us to pray, and for those whom we should pray for. Forge for them a way through the wilderness. Be for them a river in the desert. We pray for all those suffering from illness and disease. Brett and Beth, for Nick, Hank, Lee, for all those who care for them. Jesus Christ, Son of God,
guide us in wisdom, guide us in truth, guide us in love.
We pray for those who have died. May everything that has passed away be gathered into Christ's new creation, that all may see your goodness in the land of the living. Jesus Christ, Son of God,
guide us in wisdom, guide us in truth, guide us in love.
Together, God of our journey, as we walk with you on your path of obedience,
sustain us on our way and lead us to your glory.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I know this feels out of order, but we already did the confession. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Sorry, this is all we can do right now.
favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members corporately in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works that thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Our closing hymn for today is Lord, Who Throughout These 40 Days, hymn number 142. Thank you all for putting up with my little experiment. Okay,
Today was supposed to be First Food Sunday, and I forgot to remind you. So I need to look at my calendar, but probably either Monday or Tuesday, I'll send out a note, and I'll be in the office, and you can bring any food that you forgot, because I forgot to remind you. But I need to look at my calendar and see what days are which this week. Vaughn pointed out, I wrote a great announcement about an event next Saturday, starting at the First Assembly of God Church. But I forgot to tell you what it was for.
Yes, I was wondering.
So,
you were paying attention.
Yeah. I'm a part of a group that's a group of interested individuals, a part of the task force from the District Attorney's Office on Human Trafficking. And in the last year or so, they've tried to have a prayer walk probably once a quarter. So the first one for this year is on this coming Saturday. Out at the First Assembly of God Church, and we'll start there. I don't know what they have planned for that particular walk, but I would invite you to go and be supportive. Whether we realize it or not, there is a lot of human trafficking that happens in the Central Valley, and Visalia is a part of that, and the District Attorney's Office and the Sheriff's Department and Visalia PD and Porterville PD and Tulare PD have been very active over the last few months investigating and apprehending individuals who perpetrate human trafficking, especially on young people. So being able to pray for those officers, those detectives, those members of the District Attorney's Office, and the victims of human trafficking is very important.
What street is the church on?
It's on Caldwell and Acres.
Okay.
It's the really huge one out there. You'll notice that the stations of the cross are up around the church on Fridays. The church is open for quiet meditation and self-directed stations. I have booklets that I put out on the table on Friday morning, and then Terry on Friday night offers Stations of the Cross or the Way of the Cross on Zoom for people that would like to join, and because they're not able to necessarily drive down during the day.
And so you can come in your pajamas, because we're doing Compline after, which means that's the last service of the day. It's bedtime. So if you want to come in your pajamas, as long as it's not too revealing, come in your pajamas.
All right. Terry, do you have any other announcements?
I just want to remind everyone that I'm still collecting toiletries and men and women's clothing for the warehouse ministry. You can bring them to church with you, and I'll make sure they get to the warehouse. And this little list here shows the hygiene items that they are collecting. It's a little bitty square down on the lower corner of the page. They collect all the other things, too. And if you want to feel like donating to that, bring them, and we'll get them to the warehouse. And
Sherry?
Yes, can I come up?
Yeah.
Well, I wanted to, one more thing.
Okay.
Susie's birthday was this past week. So we want to wish her a happy birthday, and we want to say a prayer for her. So if you'll open your prayer books to page 830, I'm hiding behind my mat. We will say prayer number 51 together. Watch over thy child, O Lord, as her days increase. Bless and guide her wherever she may be. Strengthen her when she stands. Comfort her when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise her up if she falls. And in her heart, may thy peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of her life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And we have a little coffee hour too, so come down to the parish hall and enjoy a little snack. Thank you. What? Sherry has an announcement.
Okay, I was asked by David Kuhn to coordinate St. Paul's efforts to help our friend Beth in her recovery. She has made a truly miraculous progress in her path through this cancer, and she did some immunotherapy, and that seemed to have turned the tide. So she's well on the way to recovery. She needs food though, so I am asking for you to consider signing up for Mondays. I'm coordinating with a team of four people to do various things for Bev. And our job as parishioners is to provide food, dinners on Monday, and she's there. They want it for about four people because she's taking, well, long story short, there's some family members that also need to be fed, that are her grandchildren that are visiting her in the evenings, one of whom is vegetarian. So I have left a purple calendar on the table as you're going out in the hall, and sign up for it any Monday that you see from now till she doesn't need it anymore. And I will call the person that's coordinating massively, and she has a neat online thing that kind of confirms your reservation, so to speak. So that's the first thing. The second thing is when she's more able and more stable, she would like to start coming to church, and so she'll need people to pick her up and deliver her and then take her home at the end of the service. So I'll let you know when that happens. But keep her in your thoughts and prayers, because truly I think our prayers made a difference. And she's back on her way, which is such a blessing. So thank you for that.
And number one son, David, is leaving. He's been here from Australia through the last 3 months.
Since October,
is it been that long? Anyway, he has to get back to work. And Matthew works as the vice principal at Mount Whitney and obviously has a really full plate. So we are thankful for Sherry and the work of all these individuals who are taking on this task of coordinating her care.
But I also asked her, well, what about your lunches and breakfasts? So this is the deal. If you're ever out and about and you're sitting in a restaurant and you're having lunch or breakfast somewhere, you can call her and say, what would you like me to bring you from X restaurant or whatever? I mean, it's just a thought, but I thought, you know, that would cover her on her breakfasts and lunches occasionally. She says she's able to get up and do that, but I would prefer her not doing that if she could. She could ask some help. Thank you.
Thanks. Good job. All right, anything else? Yes, we're going to have, and Mary Lou is over there setting chairs up so that they're 6 feet apart, still trying to watch social distance. So, Deacon, will you send us out?